Welcome to A Look Ahead. We're delighted that you've decided to join us. You probably know by now that we studied the Sabbath School lessons as prepared by the Seventh-day Adventist Church. And this particular series is a very interesting one on the book of Job. This particular lesson is lesson number 3 in that series for October 15 of 2016, entitled, and using some old language, Does Job fear God for naught? It's not spelled N-O-T, but N-A-U-G-H-T.
What does that mean?
What does that mean? That's one of the things we'll have to figure out here. So let's begin with a word of prayer. Our kind and loving Father, what a privilege it is to worship you and to worship a God who makes such good sense and is so loving and kind and considerate. It's hard for us to imagine that you would even allow Satan to do what he did to Job and his family. So let's dive in now and see if we can understand a little bit more about it. Guide us as we do that is our prayer in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, we know that in the first 2 chapters of Job, we learn about a dimension of reality that without the Bible, we would know nothing. I mean, how would we know about councils in heaven? How would we know about Satan and how he started his war in heaven and all that kind of stuff? We wouldn't know anything. We're told, even in the last book of the Bible, Revelation 12, verse 12, part of the reason why we need to study this, war began in heaven, but that war has been brought down to this earth because it says, and so be glad, you heavens, and all you that live there. This is Revelation 12, 12. But how terrible for the earth and the sea, for the devil has come down to you, and he is filled with rage because he knows that he has only a little time left. Have you felt Satan's rage? In what ways? Well, we suggested in our last couple of lessons that in Job 1, Job, at the beginning, seemed to be living an idyllic life. Lots of children, everybody's behaving themselves, the richest man in the East. I mean, what more could he ask for? But completely unknown to him, he was being discussed in the councils of heaven.
He didn't ask to be for his case to be brought up?
No, he certainly didn't. Do we ever get discussed in the councils of heaven? I am certain, given what little I do know about Satan, that he was plotting, he and his angels must have plotted many times to figure out how to get Job before this story even broke out. Well, now Satan, in our story for this time, Satan appears before the heavenly council. God asked him a very uncomfortable question. Did you notice my servant Job? Of course, Satan and God both knew the story of Job very well. But in order to save face before the sons of God, Satan accused God of showing favoritism to Job and claimed that that was the reason Job served God. So, God proceeded to give his judgment of Job. And what was God's judgment of Job?
He's righteous and upright.
Yeah, make it through, yeah.
King James, I believe, says perfect and upright. But his judgment was going to be, and Satan also made his judgment about Job because he said, no, if you just let me at him, he will curse God. So God gives his judgment, Satan gives his judgment, and who turns out to be wrong? Well, that's what the book is all about. Satan chose to accuse God and Job of not playing fair. In his exceeding selfishness, Satan believed that Job was like himself. And this guy is just... He claimed, I'm not talking about Job, I'm talking about God, I'm about Satan. He claimed that if God would stop protecting Job, Job would curse God to his face. So the question, was it true that Job was just a fair-weather friend of God? Or did Job actually love God as his best friend because that was the right thing to do and because he had come to know God very well? And now you're going to tell me how that happened, right? How God, how Job got to know God so well?
Well, we've talked about this many times in this class. It's through Bible study, mm-hmm. which, of course,
Job
he didn't have a Bible. Prayer mm-hmm. and witnessing. Mm-hmm. So he could pray and he could witness, I guess, but he couldn't have Bible
study.
He didn't
do very good with his three friends, did he? So why do we
serve? They were witnessing to him.
I see. Why do we serve God? Do we serve him because it's the right thing to do?
Well, anybody who loves the truth will serve God because he is the essence of the truth.
Okay. Do we serve God because we really appreciate his character and what he has done for us?
Well, how far would you go with that if you started getting bombarded like Job did?
That's the question. As sinners, our motives are never perfect, of course, but can we get to know God well enough so that, like Job, our trust and faith in God cannot be shaken? Could we reach the place where we are unshakable? Well, I quote from Ellen White here. This is the easiest place to find it is Volume 4 of the SDA Bible Commentary, page 1161, paragraph 6. Of course, it's easy to get it by getting our handout, which you can find on our website at theox, that's theox.org, and look for the handout for this lesson. But it says, just as soon as the people of God are sealed in their foreheads, now remember, Revelation talks about us being sealed, it is not any seal or mark that can be seen, but a settling into the truth, both intellectually and spiritually, so they cannot be moved. Just as soon as God's people are sealed and prepared for the shaking, it will come. Indeed, it has begun already. The judgments of God are now upon the land to give us warning that we may know what is coming.
So if the shaking isn't happening now, it's because we're not sealed, because we're not settled into the truth.
Sounds like it, doesn't it?
That's what it sounds like. I plead guilty.
Read Job, let's look at Job 1, 20 through 22. Then Job stood up and tore his clothes. Well, we need to read the verses in between, I guess, very quickly. Starting with verse 13. One day when Job's children were having a feast at the home of their eldest brother, a messenger came running to Job. We were plowing the fields with the oxen, he said, and the donkeys were in a nearby pasture. Suddenly the Sabaeans attacked and stole them all. They killed every one of your servants except me. I am the only one who escaped to tell you. Before he had finished speaking, another servant came and said, lightning struck the sheep and the shepherds and killed them all, and I am the only one who escaped to tell you. Now I have a little hard time with this. Lightning struck the sheep, and there are thousands of them.
How did that
work out? But before he had finished speaking, another servant came and said, three bands of Chaldean raiders attacked us, took away the camels, and killed all your servants except me. I'm the only one who escaped to tell you. Before he had finished speaking, another servant came and said, your children were having a feast at the home of your eldest son when a storm swept in from the desert. It blew the house down and killed them all. I'm the only one who escaped to tell you. I mean, why didn't Job have a heart attack right there?
So he's got three servants and a wife, and that's it. That's all that's left.
Then Job stood up and tore his clothes in grief. He shaved his head and threw himself face downwards on the ground. He said, I was born with nothing, and I will die with nothing. The Lord gave, and now he has taken away. May his name be praised. In spite of everything that had happened, Job did not sin by blaming God. So?
Well, I wouldn't say that. It sounded like Job was saying he had the right to do anything. He brought me in, now he's taking me out.
You think Satan was surprised when Job responded this way? And let me just tell you, it's another suggestion. Do you think Satan and his friends just loved wiping out everything that belonged to Job? They had tried so hard to get at Job, and they thought, we've got him now. I mean, you just, maybe I'm too good at thinking like the devil, but I can just imagine.
Well, whatever happened, it probably when Job said those words, that it let all the steam out of the whole thing.
Yeah.
So.
Can you go back to the title which says, does Job fear God for naught, and explain that title and where it comes from?
Okay. This is ancient English.
Old English.
It's also based on the Hebrew originally. And when it says, does Job fear God, the word fear there can be also translated reverence and respect. So does Job respect God? Does he love God? Does he care about God? For naught means for nothing.
For nothing, yes.
Does he have no reason for his respect and reverence for God? And the answer is yes, he's got lots. Well, we're going to conclude, hopefully, that he has lots of reasons for loving and respecting God.
And that title comes from the book of Job?
Job 1, the end of verse 9 of Job 1.
And what does it say in a modern translation?
Okay. Fair enough.
Mine says, Satan replied, would Job worship you if he got nothing out of it? Is that saying the same thing?
Yes, that's basically exactly right.
Okay. Those of us who don't understand Old English.
It's really not that old anymore. It's quite a common word. And the way you can swap it around.
Yeah. As we know, God's government is based entirely on love. God himself is love, 1 John 4, 8, and 16. God asks only a response of love in return. He gives us freedom of choice. We talked a lot about that last week. As we noted in our last lesson, he refused to compel or force anyone to love him. He refuses, still. In fact, he cannot force anyone to love him because that would be contrary to his whole character and government. God wants us to serve him because it is the right thing to do, because we love him, we respect him, and we realize that he only asks us to do what is right. Of course, he cries to obedience, page 97. What does that imply? God never asks us to do anything or to believe anything that is not ultimately for our best good. Do we really believe that? Do you out there, do you really believe that? Do we think of that every time we are tempted by the devil? We should absolutely reject the principles of Satan's government. And here's a quote from the SDA Bible Commentary, not from Ellen White. Satan insinuated that Job served God from selfish motives. He attempted to deny that true religion springs from love and an intelligent appreciation of God's character, that true worshipers love religion for its own sake, not for reward, that they serve God because such service is right in itself, and not merely because heaven is full of glory, and that they love God because he is worthy of their affection and confidence, and not merely because he blesses them. Well, we've looked at this before, but look at a couple of passages, Job 2, 1 to 3. When the day came for the heavenly beings to appear before the Lord again, Satan was there among them. The Lord asked him, where have you been? Satan answered, I've been walking here and there, roaming around the earth, and I've been killing Job's children and destroying all of his wealth. And I don't think he mentioned that at the time. Did you notice my servant Job? The Lord asked. There is no one on earth as faithful and good as he is. He worships me and is careful not to do anything evil. You've persuaded me to let you attack him for no reason at all, but Job is still as faithful as ever. And basically it says the same thing back in chapter 1, verses 6 to 8. Both Satan and God knew perfectly well about Job. But Satan wanted to take the battle up another notch. He wanted to attack Job physically, and incredibly, God gave him permission to do that, short of killing Job. What would have happened if God had allowed him to kill Job?
Experiment would be over.
Yeah, the experiment would be over.
Or the demonstration, shall we say.
Yeah. Well, were the sons of God who gathered for that council already aware of the story of Job? What do you think?
I mean before it actually happened?
Yeah, before. Well, I'm not asking if they knew the future. I'm saying they're out there in their other worlds. Did they realize that there was a conflict going on? Did they know that there was this one righteous man on planet Earth that was standing up to the devil?
I think possibly, and I think they would have been severely dismayed if God had have let the devil kill Job.
Oh, yeah.
That would have gotten around like wildfire.
I wouldn't be surprised if his case came up a few times before this.
Yeah.
That God's saying, you know, he's doing pretty good down there. Everyone else is kind of tenuous.
Do you think they were shocked when God gave Satan permission to destroy Job as far as possible?
Yes.
I think they'd have watched every move that happened.
So what do you think? Don't you think from that point on to the rest of the book of Job, they were watching with their eyes glued on Job?
Definitely.
Absolutely.
And Job didn't know it at the time.
And Job didn't know it.
Well, it might have been kind of disappointing to let Satan go without the test either. So something needed to be done. And something was being done. It may not have felt very good, but
yeah.
So I think everybody was going through discipline, even the people watching.
Remember that Paul says in 1 Corinthians 4:9, "For it seems to me that God has given the very last place to us apostles, like people condemned to die in public as a spectacle," and the Greek word is theater, "for the whole world of angels and of humanity. And notice what he mentions first, the world of angels. God would not allow Satan to kill Job, although Satan would probably like to have done so, but that, of course, would have finished the experiment. By that time, the case of Job had become a universe-wide issue. And do we know about times when God collects the whole universal family together to look over some issues? Look at Daniel 7, verse 10. "And a stream of fire was pouring out from it." This is God's throne. "There were many thousands of people there to serve him, and millions of people stood before him. The court began its session, and the books were opened." Revelation 12, of course, talks about how the war started in heaven. So how do you think Satan felt about being repeatedly defeated and proven wrong before the entire universe? Think he was used to being proven wrong?
Well, I think it would make him mad.
It did, I'm sure.
I mean, he didn't feel sorry and going around crying or anything like that. He just got angry.
He was angry.
And I think he was an angry being ever since he fell. And Revelation says he came down to earth angry.
Maybe before the Job story, some of the angels, some of the sons of God out there might have been willing to be a little bit friendly with Satan. I think after this story, they would have said, I mean, when this story is going on, I think they didn't want to even, you know, stand back, you know, don't even want to get near this guy.
Well, I don't know. I think Satan didn't want to get near them.
But yet it wasn't until quite a bit later at the cross that they were convinced, and they still had some questions.
Mm-hmm. Well, Ellen White had these words to say, "But the plan of redemption had a yet broader and deeper purpose than the salvation of man."
How can that be?
Broader and deeper? How could that be? It was not for this alone that Christ came to the earth. It was not merely that the inhabitants of this little world might regard the law of God as it should be regarded, but it was to vindicate the character of God before the universe. That is a direct and pungent, just pointed, testimony about the great controversy. To this result of his great sacrifice, its influence upon the intelligences of other worlds, as well as upon man, don't forget us, the Savior looked forward when, just before his crucifixion, he said, "Now is the judgment of this world. Now shall the prince of this world be cast out." And who is the prince of this world?
Satan.
"And I, if I be lifted up from the earth, will draw all unto me," John 12:31-32. Now, who does he mean by all? The act of Christ in dying for the salvation of man would not only make heaven accessible to man, but before all the universe, it would justify God and his Son in their dealing with the rebellion of Satan. It would establish the perpetuity of the law of God and would reveal the nature and results of sin. Patriarchs and Prophets 68 and 69. So in the book of Job, we're going to see that Satan's charges against Job and against God were repeatedly proven to be false.
Going back to that, I will draw all unto me. Mm-hmm. We learned that from the King James as I will draw all men to me. And men was in italics for emphasis, right?
No.
Not for emphasis?
Not for emphasis. Words in italics in the King James Version are in italics because they're not there in the original language. It was supplied by the translators.
So Ellen White got it right, saying he will draw all unto me,
she
meaning
left
the
out.
Whole universe?
Yes, exactly. So Satan is finding himself, his mask being torn away, the truth about him is being revealed. Job's responses to Satan's attacks must have stunned Satan and his angels. It was amazing testimony before all who were aware of it. How did Job develop such a relationship with God that he was able to withstand all that we read about in Job 1 and 2?
Well, why not?
Why not?
Yeah.
Do you see a lot of Jobs walking around in our world today? And
well,
we
that
have
wasn't
a lot
your question. You're talking about him.
Yes, that is the question.
I'm not talking about the other people. You asked why was Job able to stand?
Okay.
Okay, that's what I'm narrowing to.
Yeah, but I'm asking you, okay, the reason Job becomes an issue is because he's so much different from all the other people around him. If they were all like
God
that,
said.
If they were all like that, this wouldn't have been an issue. So I'm asking you, are there lots of Jobs around us?
There might be more than one.
Well, no, don't we get to heaven? That
yeah.
full picture.
Daniel.
Well, we discovered not only that what happened in Job 1 and 2, but now we're going to find as we move on, his closest friends continued the Satan's attacks against him through the rest of the book. Is the case of Job so unusual that it is way beyond our personal experiences? Or can we learn something about our own battles with Satan from Job's experience? What do you think?
I think the latter is certainly true.
Why do we commit most of our sins that we commit?
Selfishness.
Because we're not connected with God.
Excuse me. James, the stepbrother of Jesus, in his book, small book in the New Testament, says, if people are tempted by such trials, they must not say that this temptation comes from God. For God cannot be tempted by evil, and he himself tempts no one. But people are tempted when they are drawn away and trapped by their own evil desires. Then their evil desires conceive and give birth to sin, and sin, when it is full grown, gives birth to death.
So what does drawn away mean?
Well,
isn't that drawn away from God?
Mm-hmm.
Well, separated from God. That's what.
Yes. So?
That's how it happens.
So most of our sins are not. This experience of Job is very unique. Very few of us reach the place where our righteousness becomes an issue in the great controversy. Most of us just go merrily along sinning because we want to. Further along in the book of Job, we're going to learn that in addition to all his sores, even his breath was offensive. In Job 19:17, and let me just go there, Job says, my wife can't stand the smell of my breath, and my own brothers won't come near me. Does that give you a clue about what his condition was like? Do you blame any of them? Think of all the tragedy that Job's wife went through. Do you think a book could be written about Job's wife? Myra, speak up. This is your chance. I mean, she went through incredible things, didn't she?
Yeah.
Do you think she heard all the accusations against Job that were made by Job's so-called friends, including Elihu?
I bet she was standing at the tent door, or sitting at the tent door, like Sarah was when Abraham was discussing with God and the angels.
There's another really important point that we need to make in this story that we might slide over without even recognizing it. Did any of the people who suffered and people who died in the book of Job do so because of their own sins?
Well, they were sinners.
Well, but that's not why. I mean, we would all be dead if everybody who's a sinner died, right?
But they died or suffered as a demonstration.
Okay, so the answer is no. That is another proof that sin has bad consequences even for people who have not been the direct cause of the tragedies themselves. Sin kills and damages innocent bystanders. The classical example we give in our day is the drunk driver who crosses the midline in a road and head-ons a group of people going to church, for example. Is it their fault?
Or coming home from church.
Or coming home from church. Yeah. Well, look at a couple passages in Job 2. Look at Job 2, verse 3. Did you notice my servant Job, God said, the Lord said? There is no one on earth as faithful and good as he is. He worships me and is careful not to do anything evil. You persuaded me to let you attack him for no reason at all, but Job is still as faithful as ever. So, there's no one as faithful and so forth as he is. And then Job 2:9, his wife said to him, you are still as faithful as ever, aren't you? Why don't you curse God and die? Now, it's very interesting to notice this fact. God says Job is faithful, and he commends him. His wife said Job is faithful, and what is her conclusion?
Curse God.
Curse God and die. Same expression, opposite conclusions. Why is that?
Well, his faithfulness didn't look like it landed him anything.
In the eyes of his wife.
In his well, look at the situation right there. It looked like it up to that point, there was nothing. Even though Job was the faithful, most faithful person in the whole world, look where he's at now.
Yeah.
So why don't you just curse God and die?
Well, in her grief and discouragement and probably depression, Job's wife had become an agent of Satan. Wouldn't you call her an agent of Satan?
I think in one sense you could, but when you think of losing all those children...
I'm not saying she didn't have a reason.
Yeah, no, it's...
It's like the hurricane came and you had no insurance on anything. It wiped out, the storm wiped out everything, or the earthquake wiped out everything, and absolutely no insurance.
Yeah.
The whole world...
It killed everyone, too, except the wife.
Yes.
Well, what was Job's response to his wife? Job 2, verse 10, you are talking nonsense. Yeah. When God sends us something good, we welcome it. How can we complain when he sends us trouble? In spite of everything he suffered, Job said nothing against God. Let's remember those words. Those are going to be key to a lot of things we're going to study. Job said what?
Nothing.
Nothing against God.
In other words, he didn't curse him.
Mm-hmm. Well, look at Philippians 4:11-13. This is Paul's words. And I am not saying this because I feel neglected, and this is written from prison. I know what it is to be in need and what it is to have more than enough. I have learnt this secret so that anywhere, at any time, I am content, whether I am full or hungry, whether I have too much or too little, I have the strength to face all conditions by what? By the power that Christ gives me. Could we say that? Well, do we think God should put a hedge around us? Do we expect him to do that?
I think we have more of a hedge than most of us realize in day-to-day living.
Do we believe that in this world of sin we should only receive good and not bad?
Well, that would be good.
I'll vote for that.
Well, both Job and Paul have proved that they could face almost any condition through the strength of Christ. Job had already shown that his faith was genuine. He was going to serve God no matter what came his way. Well, as Gordon has suggested several times, Satan has been incredibly successful with the human race. We're all sinners. He had managed to tempt Adam and Eve in the Garden of Eden. Every one of their descendants has followed their example. Surely Satan thought he could find a way to cause Job to sin. While Satan is not mentioned by name through the rest of the book, he certainly did not give up his attacks on Job. As we already know, he began his work through Job's so-called friends, who accused Job of many completely outrageous things. We're going to see some incredible things that his friends accused Job of. So, of course, one of the biggest reasons for studying a book like this is, how could we develop the kind of relationship with God that Job had?
You know, I'm realizing that we're assuming that people realize the next conversation in Job 2:4, the conversation and 5 and so on, the second conversation between Job between Satan and God, but we haven't read that or stated it.
Yeah, we probably should read that. Thank you for bringing that out. Let me just jump there. Very quickly.
2:4.
Yeah.
Well, even start with 3 again.
Why am I? Yeah, let's go here. Okay, yeah, let's do that. God, of course, said once again in the second council, "Did you notice my servant Job?" the Lord asked. "There's no one on earth as faithful and good as he is. He worships me and is careful not to do anything evil. You persuaded me to let you attack him for no reason at all, but Job is still as faithful as ever." Satan replied, "A person will give up everything in order to stay alive. But now, suppose you hurt his body, he will curse you to your face." Now Satan is getting desperate. So the Lord said to Satan, "All right, he's in your power, but you are not to kill him." Then Satan left the Lord's presence and made sores break out all over Job's body. Job went and sat by the rubbish heap and took a piece of broken pottery to scrape his sores. Try to imagine that. His wife said to him, "You are still as faithful as ever, aren't you? Why don't you curse God and die?" And that's where that expression comes in. Thank you for mentioning that. We need to get that part of the story in there. Well, do you think the 144,000 at the end that the book of Revelation talks about will have the kind of relationship with God that Job had? They're going to have to stand through the final plagues. And at that point in time, what's Satan going to be doing? He's going to be desperate. He's going to throw everything at them that God will absolutely allow, right?
We have reason to think that the 144,000 will not be killed, but they might get the sores just like Job did, and they might lose all their possessions just like Job did.
Can we get to know God so well that Satan's counterfeit, we can identify it immediately so we will not be deceived?
Hopefully.
Hopefully. Look at a couple of expressions in these, couple of special expressions in these two chapters. Job 1, verse 22, "In spite of everything that had happened, Job did not sin by blaming God." And look at Job 2, verse 10. "Job answered, 'You are talking nonsense.'" This is to his wife. "In spite of everything he suffered, Job said nothing against God." Are those two expressions equal? Pretty much, huh?
Yeah.
We're not trying to imply by any of this that Job was not a sinner. Job needed his Savior just like all the rest of us. Not primarily because he was born in sin, although that is true, but because he sinned frequently himself. In 1 John 1, and that's Romans 5:12 and other places, Romans 3:23. 1 John 1:10 says, if we say that we have not sinned, we make a liar out of God and his word is not in us. So that's pretty clear, right? How would you compare the temptations and trials of Job with those of Jesus himself?
there's people kind of going against Christ, like Job's friends went against him.
Mm-hmm.
So that's one aspect.
Similarities.
Yeah, exactly.
They were both pretty close to, well, Jesus was clearly sinless. Mm-hmm. Job was pretty close.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Well, we know about, I'm not going to take time to read it right now, but we know about the temptations of Christ. What were the three temptations of Christ in his early, before he began his ministry?
To
turn the stones into bread. Yeah. And he was taken to the top of the temple. Because it says in the Old Testament, you can cast yourself down and God will protect you. Satan said, why don't you just cast yourself down? You'll prove that you're the Son of God. And then he was taken and he was shown all the wealth of the whole world. He said, just, it's yours, I'll give it to you. But Job's trials were quite different from the temptation of Jesus. Satan was able to tempt Jesus on a completely different level than any ordinary human could be tempted, because Jesus had the ability to exercise his divine authority and power if he chose to do so. Job, of course, was never tempted to turn stones into bread. But both Job and Jesus completely rejected Satan's approaches and his temptations. After making his claims and accusations recorded in Job 1 and 2, Satan apparently disappeared. Why do I say apparently?
Because he worked through the friends, the so-called friends.
However, he actually began to work through Job's friends. After the temptations of Jesus, what happened? Satan had to leave because Jesus commanded him to do so.
But Satan still worked through the disciples and everyone else around.
Obviously. Can we tell Satan to get behind us, leave us alone?
We can.
Yeah.
Do we mean it?
Say it as convincingly.
We don't say it convincingly enough.
Well, if you have Jesus with you, Jesus can do it.
Mm-hmm.
What does that mean?
Well, you've got the person that gave the command with you. You don't have to worry about whether your command's going to work or not, because Jesus is with you. He's the one that had the original command, and he can do it.
Okay, let me ask you a question. Here's what was Jesus' greatest temptation through his entire life?
Greatest temptation?
Mm-hmm.
Probably to abandon us.
He was willing to die for us, even though he was tempted to believe that he might separate himself, that doing that might separate him permanently from his Father. Desire of Ages, 753, paragraph 2. What was Jesus' worst concern?
That he would not see God again, that he would be confined to eternal death.
In other words, the thing that tore him up, that bothered him the most, that was that he couldn't reach through Satan and feel God's presence. Do we get upset when we can't feel God's presence? Or do we just go merrily on our way sinning?
Mostly the latter.
Philippians 2, verses 5 to 8 is a wonderful passage. The attitude you should have is the one that Christ Jesus had. He always had the nature of God, but he did not think that by force, remember we've talked about the force and God's use of force, he did not think that by force he should try to remain equal with God. Instead of this, of his own free will, he gave up all he had and took the nature of a servant. He became like a human being and appeared in human likeness. He was humble and walked the path of obedience all the way to the cross, his death on the cross. And I love the way Phillips translates that. He said, the death of a common criminal. Could we actually have the attitude that Jesus had? Is that possible? Well, the more we can think and act like Jesus, the better it will be both now and for eternity. Here's an interesting point. There's an interesting phenomenon in these first two chapters of Job. The word translated as curse in Job 1:5, Job 2:9, Job 1:11 is actually the Hebrew word for bless. Why is that? The Hebrew word comes from the root BRK. By the way, do you recognize that word from anywhere?
BRK?
Mm-hmm. That's the Hebrew version without any vowels.
Oh. Sounds like a restaurant.
Have you ever heard of anybody by the name of Barack?
Never.
Never? Your perfect illustration right there of what this is all about. What's happening here is this is a euphemism. The writer, Moses, and maybe at the suggestion of God, and maybe on his own, it's hard to know, he's saying, when he's quoting Job's wife, he says, why don't you bless God and die? What is he really saying? Why don't you curse God, right? Yeah. So this is a sarcastic comment. But the actual word is the word for bless instead of curse. And this word is used all through the Old Testament for blessing. It's in Genesis 1:22 where God talks about blessing the creatures he had made. It's in Psalm 68:8, just a couple of spots. Oh, bless God. Oh, bless our God, you peoples. So here's some real sarcasm in the Bible.
Now, I don't understand where that came from, where you're coming from on that.
Well,
the bless.
Well, it says in Job 1:5, for example, it says the morning after each feast, Job would get up early and offer sacrifice. I'm sorry, let me go down here to my right place. Job 2:9. His wife said to him, you are still as faithful as ever, aren't you? Why don't you curse God and die? Mm-hmm. But the word for curse there in the original Hebrew is actually bless God.
Yes. Being sarcastic.
The word is literally bless God, but she's saying it sarcastically. That's what we're saying.
Okay.
Message Bible says it a little differently, but
yeah.
Still holding on, his wife said, still holding on to your precious integrity, are you? Question. Curse God and be done with it.
Yeah. Well, yeah. And that's the basic idea, isn't
same
it?
Same thing, yeah.
So, as long as we live here on planet Earth, we must constantly be aware of the great controversy going on around us and in us. There are times when the things which happen to us may be a part of the great controversy and we not even know it. Think of the story of Job. God will be faithful, of course, no matter what. So why was Job so faithful to this experiment?
It was his nature. Yeah. He was.
What does that mean?
He'd gotten to be so close to God that was how he was.
Yeah. God was Job's best friend, and Job refused to curse his best friend. Does that inspire you? Does it scare you? Do you think God's people at the end of time will suffer less than Job did?
No.
At the end of this world, remember, the point I always make is this. Satan is going to know he's at the end of his rope. What do you think he's going to do about that?
I think what we're seeing elsewhere in the world is going to be here sooner or later.
Yeah.
Satan's learned from his past few mistakes.
Mm-hmm.
Learned to be even more devious.
Well, let's see if we can spell out what similarities there are between these experiences of Job and the temptations of Christ. One, both were tempted, I think we can say fairly, both were tempted as much as God would allow. Wouldn't you say that's true? In other words, as much as God allowed Satan, he wasn't allowed to kill them. That's about the only limit, right? Jesus, of course, ultimately actually did die. Two, Satan was determined to get each of them to sin. But in both cases, he failed. Both of them stood firm under the most difficult of circumstances and proved that God was right in his judgment and claims about them, and that Satan was wrong. They each suffered not only enormous physical pain, but also the pain of being basically rejected by those who should have loved them and supported them. Jesus' greatest fear was that he would be eternally separated from his Father. Job's greatest worry was that Job was no longer communicating with him. So he felt like he'd already been separated from God, right? Job was abandoned and accused by his best friends. Jesus was deserted and betrayed by his closest friends. So what should we learn from that sequence?
That it could happen to us as well.
It could happen to us, and it's not going to be a pleasant experience, is it? Well,
are we inviting ourselves to be part of the 144,000 and go through that also?
I think that would be nice. Not the experience, but being a part of that group. Well, we have learned about councils that met in heaven and Satan's accusations against God and Job. How many councils did Satan have with his evil angels to discuss ways in which they could get Job into sin?
I hadn't thought of it quite that way. That's an interesting way to think.
Yeah.
They probably had, shall we say, daily or at least weekly sessions. What are we doing this week with so-and-so and so-and-so? And what's your progress on Job?
Do you think Satan ever took it easy on Job?
No. He thought he had him so close.
Here's a question. Do you think Job was a greater friend of God or a greater friend of his wife? Now, that's a terrible question to ask, but
I think when it came down to it, he was on God's
side. I think at the end, his wife didn't want to have anything to do with him when he smelled bad and all this kind of stuff. God was still right there.
Yeah.
But Job wasn't talking. I mean, God wasn't talking to him.
Yeah, it's true. Can you imagine his wife? Job, did you get something to eat today? I mean, I'm not trying to be funny. I mean, just... I mean, try to imagine. Try to seriously imagine the situation. Like Job's, most of our temptations are not on a theoretical or even theological level, but rather on a very personal one. He had every reason to give up on God and die, but he did not. Does that give us courage to stand up under every kind of adversity? It should be clear already, in our study of the book of Job, that the main issue is God's character and his capacity and ability to correctly judge others. Satan wanted the universe to believe that God had misjudged him. He was desperate to prove that God's judgment was faulty in one way or another, but he failed. He wants us to believe that God is a tyrant who manipulates human beings by whatever means, whether fear or even bribery, into submission and obedience. By getting to know God well enough, can we be fully convinced that he is a loving heavenly Father who was willing to die to prove the truth of his claims and the falsehood of Satan's accusations? What kind of a God do you worship? Well, we all worship the true God, the one right God, right? How would you respond if your family members and all of your closest friends began accusing you of being a terrible sinner?
They'd probably be right.
You know, there are people, there's experiments done, and sociology experiments done, where they know a person is perfectly healthy, there's nothing wrong with him at all, he comes to work, and the people at work have been set up, and they say, "Oh, you look awful today, what's wrong?" And by the middle of the afternoon, these people go home. They're sure there's something wrong with them. There was nothing wrong with them at all, except that people said, what's wrong with you?
It's true.
Well, how often are we asked to stand singly and alone in defense of our faith? You recognize those words? Ellen White says we're going to have to do that. Well, each of us has a picture of God in our minds that we worship. It's not the complete picture of God. We'll be learning about God for the rest of eternity. Oh, we have just a little snippet of the truth about God. We worship God as we understand them to be. So what does that mean? Well, the Bible describes God as using many metaphors. He's called a shepherd, Psalm 23:1, a judge, Psalm 7:11, a father, Psalm 89:26, a rock and a fortress, Psalm 18:2, even a warrior, Psalm 78:65-66. That's just one book in the Bible. There are many other things. He's even called a mother hen, isn't he? There are many other things that we learn about God from other places in Scripture. But Satan is determined to distort our picture of God. If your image, I'm speaking to you out there, if your image of God is static and not growing from year to year, are you worshiping an idol?
Do you think yes?
I think so. Can you even imagine going through a Job-like experience? What if you lost all your possessions and all your children in a short period of time and your friends told you to curse God and die? Could you survive it? Well, there's a lot of theological issues, as we've already suggested, that are brought up by these first two chapters in Job. One obvious one is Satan is the accuser and God is the defender. One of the questions that comes up in the first two chapters of Job is, what kind of success can Satan have and has had in accusing God and to the rest of the to us and to the rest of the sons of God throughout the universe? Has he been very successful? Well, we talked about this earlier, but let me just mention it now. Look at Luke 10:18. Jesus answered them, I saw Satan fall like lightning from heaven. Now, we read Revelation 12, which says he fell back in the beginning. Luke 10:18 seems to suggest that he's going to fall again after the crucifixion and resurrection of Jesus. Well, by whatever means Satan is able to get the attention of God and the rest of the sons of God, it is amazing that he's allowed to make his accusations freely before all of them. I mean, why do these people are they even willing to listen to Satan? Well, we remember Revelation 12:7-9, where it talks about Satan being fallen from heaven, the war that started up there. There's a couple of facts we need to think about that might help us to understand how Satan communicates with the rest of the universe. One, God is omnipresent. So wherever Satan is, God is there and can dialogue with him. So Satan doesn't necessarily have to go physically to somewhere where God is in another part of the universe in order to make his accusations against God. God can hear him from wherever he is. Don't we believe that God can hear our prayers? Do we have to go to heaven for God to hear our prayers? No. Certainly not. So, of course, he can hear Satan's accusations just as well as he can hear our prayers. Well, it seems that Satan has free access to heaven, or had free access to heaven, up until the time of the ministry and life and death of Jesus. But as we've suggested, Luke 10:18 and John 12:31, apparently after the death of Christ, the people up there don't want to have anything more to do with Satan. So he's kept out of heaven because of what?
It's not by force. It's because no one will listen to him.
No one. So even if he went there, nobody would be willing to listen to him. So ultimately, of course, during the millennium, Satan is going to be confined to this earth because no one will be willing to listen to him. Revelation 20, verses 1. Maybe we should just read that, because those are incredible verses. Look at Revelation 20, the first three verses. Then I saw an angel coming down from heaven, holding in his hand the key of the abyss and a heavy chain. I wish we had time to discuss all these symbols. He seized the dragon, that ancient serpent, that is, the devil or Satan, he wants to make sure you know who he's talking about, and chained him up for 1,000 years. Now, what kind of a chain do you use to chain up the devil?
The chain by which no one will listen to him.
The angel threw him into the abyss, locked it, and sealed it so they could not deceive the nations anymore until the 1,000 years were over. So what is he chained up from doing? He can't deceive anybody anymore. After that, he must be let loose for a little while.
So either the people are dead, mm-hmm. or they know the truth about Satan and they won't listen to his foolishness anymore.
They've gone to heaven. Yeah.
There are the two groups.
Yeah, exactly. I wish we had time to talk about that. There's some very interesting implications of all that. In what ways does God impose limits on Satan? Do we have a clear example in the past where God imposed limits on Satan?
Yeah. Garden of Eden, the tree.
The Garden of Eden. He confined Satan to the tree. In our day, is God gradually withdrawing his limitations on Satan and his protection of this earth and possibly us? Is that why so many terrible things are happening around us? There's an interesting ambiguity found in Revelation 14:7. We've got to do this quickly. He said in a loud voice, "Honor God and praise his greatness, for the time has come." Now my version says, it says literally, "For the hour of God's judgment has come." Does that mean the hour when God judges us, or does that mean the hour when we judge him?
Both.
I'm sure it means both. So, I hope you found these discussions of the first couple of chapters of Job very interesting. It's going to be an incredible time together during these next few weeks. Plan to be with us every week. Think about these questions. Discuss them with your friends. Get our study guides if you've forgotten some of the questions we've raised. And make this 3-month period a blessing. Our kind and loving Father, it is with great anxiety, but great enthusiasm that we read this story. Not because we wish we could go through Job's experience, and we might have that experience sometime in the future, but because it's so exciting to read about your role in all of that. Help us to get to know you so well that never could we be deceived, is our prayer in Jesus' name. Amen.